exalted.
Amen.
Are you seeing me? You know, for those like me who have done a PhD, mine I did in Russia, and one of the lecturers taught us that even in classes, people tend to, you know, see. So my conscience is telling me that I'm lying. So, I want us to stand up. I want us to stand up. Open your Bible in the book of Acts, chapter number 16. The book of Acts, chapter 24, verse number 16. Last time, Brother Jemma taught us a very good message. And if you can remember something, is that God always cares for us. Amen?
Amen.
God cares for us. And we should be reminded also that even today, that God cares for us. Amen?
Amen.
Always let us be able to trust God. Because God cares for us. Amen?
Amen.
But apart from God caring for us, there's something we need to do also. Amen?
Amen.
I remember my first message to preach on Sunday night. God gave me a message about the wall, building the wall. And we need to build some walls, amen?
Amen.
And today we're going to build a wall of serving with a good conscience.
Conscience.
That's the problem with my English teacher. So, conscience. So I want us to read Acts chapter 24, verse number 16. Are you there?
Amen.
Let us go together. One, two, go.
And herein will I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men.
I read again. And herein do I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you today. God, I pray that you may use me. Lord, allow me to say the things you want me to say. God, I pray that this message will not just be another message, but God, we are going to learn something. And our life will be impacted because you have spoken to us this hour. We pray that our hearts, that we will open our hearts, O God, and you speak to us. Be this short in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, this is our 72 topic. Lesson number 72. One thing that I love about BBC is that you can see there's continuation of study. Amen? You know, it's very hard to find a church that is teaching this kind of lessons. Lesson 1, 2, 3, and they'll be committed to teach until now we're in number 72. Amen?
Yeah.
And we thank God that we have a church like BBC. Amen? And you should thank God that you're a member of BBC.
Amen.
Now, this topic, chapter number 24, is a scenario whereby Paul was taken to a court. Paul was taken to a court, and from there he was trying to defend himself from Pharisees and from Ananias, who he had his lawyer who was trying to speak for him. And they accused Paul with so many things. They accused Paul in so many things. In this passage, we see the high priest Ananias and later he has hired Tertullus bringing accusation against Paul before Felix. The governor at Casa, they brought all sorts of accusation against Paul, claiming a pestilent fellow and the king leader of the Nazarenes. Amen?
Amen.
Paul was facing so much accusation. But you see, in verse chapter number 16, Paul says something in the defense. Paul stated his desire and go to have a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. Amen?
Amen.
You know, Paul was a spiritual giant. Amen?
Amen?
Paul was a spiritual giant. And that does not mean that Paul was an extra person. He had some extra abilities. No. Also today, if you want God to use you, the way he used Paul, he can use you. Amen?
Amen.
And like Paul, we also ought to have a good conscience toward God and toward men. this something, Mr. This is Paul integrity. Amen. Amen. This something from the side of Paul. He did something. And one of the things he did is serve God in the good concerns. But my question to us today is he already concerns you? Your conscience right, is your conscience right today? Is there something that someone can point and say, no, here you're wrong? You know yourself. And today we are going to learn different kind of conscience. And number one, the word there is the dynamic of the right conscience. The dynamic of right conscience. Paul often mentioned the importance of clear and good conscience. This is not the inner self. No, this inner self, but what is it? It is the conscience is defined as the inner faculty that knows our spirit and approves when we do right and accuses when we do wrong. It is we know that rest the light in. The light is the revealer of the manner and motives of man. So today we are going to study a different kind of conscience. Number one, A is the good conscience. The good conscience. We have different kind of conscience. Now, the first one is the good conscience. In the book of Acts 2, chapter 23, verse number 1, the Bible says, "And Paul earnestly, beholding the council, said, Men and brethren, I have lived in all good concerns before God until this day." Amen?
Amen.
And also we see in verse 2 of the Paul, he said that holding faith and good concerns, which some have been put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. Amen?
Amen.
Has made shipwreck. Somebody say, there is no softer people than a pure concerns. A good concerns is sensitive to things that are unacceptable to God. Amen?
Amen?
Now, we all know what is a sin. And when we start committing sin, it's something that when we take example, like first time, if someone is a robber today, if someone is a robber, or someone is smoking, or someone is lying always, or someone is any kind of sin, mention it, any kind of sin. It is started somewhere. Amen?
Amen.
And here we see a good concern is what? A good concern is sensitive to things that are unacceptable to God. You want to do something, but something is saying, this is not right. Amen? This is not right. Don't do this before. This is not right. This is not right. Don't do this. Now, a good conscience is developed by the grace of God. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
For you to have a good conscience, you need to have a grace of God. In the book of Titus, the Bible says, for the grace, Titus chapter 2, verse 11 to 12, the Bible says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared in all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteous, and godly in this present world. Amen?
Amen.
God's grace creates a holy disposition in the believers, in the believer. You see, we are living the world whereby people are no more conscious. Amen?
Amen.
People are doing so many things. And it is sad to see that not only unbelievers, even believers, they are doing things that really wonder why. Because the conscience is already there. Amen? And for us to have a good conscience, we need to understand that it comes through the grace of God. Now, in 2 Corinthians 1:12, for our rejoicing is this, the testimony of our conscience that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fresh wisdom, but by grace of God, we have had our conversation in the world and more abundantly in one. So, one of the conscience we learn today is that there is good conscience. Amen? The good conscience is that when you are doing the right thing, that is acceptable to God. That's where you have a good conscience. And another concern we see is B is the defiler of conscience.
What is this called?
Conscience. When I say conscience, you know what I'm talking about this one, yeah? So, this one is making me sweat. So, now, B is the defiler of conscience. Okay? You see, everybody, you start by having good conscience. Amen? And slowly, when you start accepting sin in your life, when you start accepting those things which are not right, now you start having what you call a deferred conscience. Note, a man with a deferred conscience is a man whose heart is not receiving the light of the truth so clearly. This conscience is not a seeker. Amen?
Amen.
What I'm talking about is that, I remember when I was in Kenya, after I got saved in 2008, date 11 July, that's when I received Christ as my personal Savior. After 1 month, I started working in the Mission Media. For those who are in Kenya, from Kenya, they know the Mission Media company. I was a driver there for the newspaper, transporting the newspaper. And these people there, and my colleagues, my partners, there's a way they could steal some newspapers and sell. And you know, I was telling them, why are you doing this? This is not right. You are making good money. You know, especially my partner, he was making a very good money. Now, I was warning them, stop doing this. But you know, that is a good concern, amen?
Amen.
I was having a very good concern. Now, one day, it happened that I was given the money to put the fuel. I was always being given the money, but that day, I was given the money to put the fuel. And what happened is that, I realized I will do this. For those who are driving the manual cars, they know when you put neutral in it, the car will just roll. It will not consume much fuel, okay? So I was given 1,000 note. So I decided, let me save 100, and put 900. So that means 100, I would eat chips and that time, I would take some chips and chicken. So that's what I did. You see, my conscience first was right, but here I have allowed something to happen to me. That instead of putting 1,000 in the car, the fuel, the 1,000 that was given, I removed 100. You know, I'll just put a feet, you know, not very much, then I'll take some shit. Now I started defiling my conscience. Okay? And I'm telling you before time, and remember from that time, as time goes by, I was the one knowing how the newspaper are coming out. I was the one who is, he knows how many newspapers will come and how much we make today. I'm the one now stealing the newspaper. You see, just a few months ago I was telling them not to do this, but it is started summer. I defied my conscience by allowing this to happen to me. Amen?
Amen.
And that's how I defied conscience start. You don't see, you don't do this, but the moment you do it just a little bit, you start defiling your conscience. Amen?
Amen?
So one conscience is if you have a good conscience, and one you have defiled conscience. And some of you here are having very good conscience. But some already have defiled their conscience. Amen?
Amen?
In the matters of doctrine, in the matters of sin, how is your conscience? Amen? And B, also be right about the evil conscience. In Hebrews, the Bible says, 10:22-23, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that he has promised. An evil conscience is the result of a consistent sin and neglect of Bible principles. Amen?
Amen.
You see, you start by good conscience. You defile your conscience. Now you start walking with what? Evil conscience. Why? You keep on doing that sin. You start now, that is now iniquity. You start that sin become normal to you. Amen? Something that it was not right. You know, in Kadwa before, some of the drivers came and they could not steal the money of the company. But when people are stealing, they are afraid. Like me, when I was stealing those newspapers the first time, I was very afraid, you know. I was afraid. Caution is telling me, don't do this. But slowly, so I continued doing that. Now I become, it was normal for me to know how many newspapers would come out, coordinate, and all those kinds. I did those things. And that, now I was having evil concerns. And remember, I was saved. I was saved already. But you see the things I was doing. Now, some Christians today say that preaching or the leadership requires a requirement of a ministry as the creators of the evil or guilt concerns. For we are not advocating a fresh type of guilt. The truth is that biblically, many people have concerns that have deteriorated because of sin. Amen? Many people here, so many people, their concerns have deteriorated. This one way or another, we find out there's some sin that we are doing. There's some things that we are doing which are not right. You know, there are those things in public, there are those things you know yourself there in secret. It started somewhere. And that's why you say that many people have concerns that have deteriorated because of sin. It is just like the devil to point the blame of the Satan rather than at the sin. Amen? Amen? And when we defy our conscience, we always have reasons. We always try to give reason why we are doing this. Amen? Amen? So, apart from the evil conscience, the last conscience we see is the seared conscience. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 4, 1 and 2, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the later times some shall depart from the faith. Amen?
Amen.
Some shall depart from what?
Faith.
Giving heed to giving spirit and doctrines of the devil, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their concerns seared with a hot iron. Amen? This person that is having the same concerns, this person's concerns is so limited in its ability to feel the conviction of God. That person accepts and propagates false doctrine. Amen?
Yeah.
Today we just learned about, for the last 3 lessons we learned about the King James Bible. Amen? Yeah. Now your conscience is telling you, this is the right Bible. Don't use this one. Because some of us like me are used to have the NIV. The conscience now, you have learned something, amen?
Amen.
So, but if you keep neglecting and you keep on using that NIV, slowly you sleep on that. And it will come a time that you don't get a conviction, amen? It's okay for you to do it. And that's what happened to me. I'm giving my testimony when I was working in the newspaper because first I could hear the conscience, stop. But because of I continue doing it. It came out. I could even budget now. You see? I could not hear the voice of God anymore. I could not hear because the conscience already sear. Amen? Amen? For those who are, you know, how you in Kenya when for a small car or the car, how you cut the horns and there's a way you slap you rush. Yeah, with a hot iron. That's what we did to our conscience. That's what we did to our conscience when it is seared. And my conscience was not there anymore. The sad thing is that if you entangle yourself or you compromise in one sin, slowly you start doing many other sins. And I look at myself and I'm working the newspaper company and I'm like, I'm making a lot of money here. Now it was worse. Now I could do so many things. I could carry passengers with the company car. I could do so many things now. You see, but you see where I just started? 100 years. 100 shillings when I did not put the petrol. But that was normal for me to do that. And I look at my life and it was a mess. I have money, I have everything, but because I thank God I was saved, the Spirit of God was still with me and He was speaking to me. And you know what? I was making a lot of money, but one day I said, I will not go to work anymore. I need to stop this. I need to stop this. And I said, I actually did not go to work. And I said, because my life was immense. Since I was getting money, but the conscience was not there anymore. It took the Holy Ghost in me to quicken that conscience back again. Amen? And I pray that today, as you are listening to this, some of you have good conscience. But take heed that you may not fall. Amen?
Amen.
Some have defied their conscience. Come back. Some have evil conscience. Some have already seared their conscience. You take the grace of God. You need to realize it. But this is wrong. What I'm thinking is wrong. You've already gone beyond of the beyond. But the good thing is that when you come before God and you repent your sin, amen? You know, I came to God and I repented my sin. I repented what I was doing. And I quit the job and my life changed, amen?
Amen.
My life changed and my conscience. And when I came to Doha, when I was doing the taxi driver at first, people used to make a lot of money by not using meter. But I said, I will never touch. Amen?
Amen.
I will never again defend my conscience. Amen?
Amen.
I'll never again. And I will never touch that money. So examine yourself. Know what kind of a conscience you have. Now, the question is this. And that is number two now. The development of right conscience. The development of what? A right? The development of a right conscience. Now, Paul says in verse 16, here do I exercise myself. Amen? Exercise requires a goal. How do you develop a good conscience? How do you develop a good conscience? We need to do this. We need to have a goal. Amen? What is your goal? Paul's desire was to please the Lord. Jesus is the goal. Amen?
Amen.
When you make a goal to have a good conscience, what is your goal? Your goal is to please who? God. Amen?
Amen?
I was not doing that to please my company. I was doing that to please God.
Amen?
So be sure that you have a goal. Your goal is to please God. And B, exercise requires discipline. Amen?
Amen.
Exercise by what? Discipline. Paul was willing to defeat his body, to sacrifice things that were not easily evil, necessarily evil, but things which might hinder his work for Christ. Amen?
Amen?
You need to exercise for you to have a good conscience. Amen? You need to develop it, focusing on Jesus Christ. Another thing to be disciplined. Amen?
Amen?
When you say you won't do it, you won't do it. Amen? When you say you won't go there, you won't go there. But you see, you don't read an IV anymore, you don't need it anymore, amen? And there are some things that reader will lay aside in order to be effective for Christ. This philosophy is not popular in our day, but it is scripture, amen?
Yeah.
It is scripture. Just as no one loses weight accidentally, no one develops a good conscience accidentally, amen?
Yeah.
It requires regular, disciplined living to maintain this breakthrough for a godly living. Amen?
Amen.
You know, you can be sick. You can, maybe you don't have money, but if your conscience is right in God, it's joy. Amen?
Amen.
It's joy. If your life is right in God, and even you don't have money, you are sick, you have so many problems, but your conscience is right in God. That is the greatest joy. Amen?
Yeah.
And some of you here can witness and say that. Amen?
Yeah.
So, exercise to have a good conscience. Amen? And now, the thing is that, number three is the display of a right conscience. How do you display the display of a right conscience? Paul was void of offense. Paul was void of offense. Paul avoided so many things. He had not stumbled. Paul never stumbled. And so it can be to you today. Why? How do you display the same consciousness? Number A, toward whom? Toward God. Amen? The Bible says in 1 Samuel 16:7, but the Lord said unto Samuel, look not unto his countenance, or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not a man's seed. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Amen?
Amen.
You know, when you look each other today, you look normal. You look very normal. But our conscience, down there, how is your conscience? Amen? Amen. Toward who? Not me. Not toward your friend, but toward who?
God.
How is your conscience?
Toward God.
Amen? So, the display of right conscience is toward who? God. Not to show other people. It is toward who? God. Amen?
Amen.
And the Christian life is a relationship. Amen?
Amen?
The Christian life is a relationship. We are separated from the world and separated unto God. The world behind us, living for God. Amen?
Amen?
There is no in between. Amen?
Amen.
It is either you are for God or you are not for God. Amen?
Amen?
Now, every relationship generates laws consistent with the one to whom we are relating. Like me and my dear wife, Mama. Mama. Can you stand up this year? That's my wife. But we have some rules, amen?
Amen?
We have some, for our relationship to be right, for our relationship to be without so many things, without some, we have some rules, amen? There's some things I don't do. There's some things she cannot do. There's some things even they are good to do, but we avoid to do them for the sake of our relationship. Amen?
Amen.
And that's how also it works also with God. Amen?
Amen?
Now, since God looks on the heart, he knows whether our outward performance matches our true desires. Amen?
Amen.
If our heart is not right, our outward behavior will not remain right for long. I repeat that one. If our heart is not right, our outward behavior will not remain right for long. You know what? You cannot pretend for long.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Mm-hmm.
We cannot. We cannot pretend for long. We cannot. Thus, standards are not the goal. Jesus is the goal. Amen?
Amen.
We display our good conscience towards God and also now towards man. How do we do this? In separation. Amen? How do you display your good conscience in a man? People will see through in separation. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4:2, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's concerns in the sight of God. 2 Corinthians 5:9. Wherefore, we labor that, whether present or absent, we may be acceptable of him. Now, all of us stumble from time to time. Amen? Yeah? We are not perfect, but that is not an excuse. If you are like me, sometimes you fall, amen? Yeah? Because you are still in the flesh. But we have God who loves us. We have Jesus Christ who shed his blood. That when we fall, we come back quickly, repent the sin, and come back to the path. Amen?
Amen?
That's what we should do when we fall. Because one way or another, we are going to fall. But when we fall, come back immediately.
Amen.
Don't wait, amen? Don't stay there, because if you stay there,
slowly
is going to develop what? Seared conscience. Now, something you hear Christians claim that they have liberty to do certain things that other Christians abstain from doing. They do, but we must endeavor.
Endeavor.
Yeah, that one. But we must, that one, maintain a right maintain a right concern as to what or who observe our rights. Amen? You see, after this, we are going to go outside. Amen? We are going to go back to our accommodation. We are going to go back to our company. We are going to go to different places. What do people see in you? Amen? What do you display? Is a conscious light? Or are you living a separated life? Or you are mixing? People cannot even know. You remember Noah and Lot? You remember Lot? Lot, he went to talk to his, sons-in-law in Jericho. The Jericho was supposed to be destroyed, but he was told, go and bring them. Sodom and Gomorrah, he was supposed to be destroyed. And he was told, go and tell them to come. So that they were released. But when he went there, the Bible says, when he told them that, it's like, he was mocking. They couldn't believe him. It's just, you know why? Because he mixed himself. Amen?
Amen.
Today, there are some people you cannot say, tell them that I'm saved. You are shy to say that you are saved. Why? Because your life is not right. Amen?
Amen.
What do they see? What do they see? What do they see? Amen? So it's a challenge for us today. It's a challenge for us today that we should live a separated life. Amen?
Amen.
There must be a distinction between those who are for God and those who are not for God. Amen?
Amen?
Number two, how do we exercise this toward men in soul winning? Paul wanted to speak the truth to every man. Every man will hear and be saved. That is what Paul wants. The reason why you live a life of good concerns is because you want people to come. You want people to come to be saved. Amen?
Amen.
Not for people to talk about that guy or that guy is, you know, he works. No. For the people to come and desire that kind of life you have. Amen?
Amen.
And when they come, they get saved. Now, 2 Corinthians, as I finish, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 2, the Bible says, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor uttering the word of God deceitfully, but manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves every man concerns in the sight of God. Amen?
Amen.
Concerns is the faculty of mind which distinguishes between right and wrong. Amen?
Amen.
We must develop good concerns. Amen?
Amen.
We must develop good concerns. The Bible says the implication is that the right course of preaching combined with the right manner of life will be used of God to be affirmed in the conscience of the people. Now, we see the principle of separation for the sake of soul winning dramatically illustrated in the life of Lot. That's what I was saying. When he went to warn his family members, they would not leave Sodom. His failure to maintain a good conscience toward men cost his own life, their lives. Amen? That's so sad. One day I was talking to one of them. He is little known in Kenya, but he's one of the richest people in Kenya. And I was working as a houseboy in his house. And when I came to Doha, that time when I was working to him, I was not saved that time. But when I came to Doha, because when I came to Doha, I can say, actually when I joined BBC, I can see that's when in matters of doctrine. Now, we used to communicate with him, and I used to tell him, some things you're doing here are not right. Because as a houseboy, I know the things he is doing. And one day I talked to him and I told him that, you know, you might not care about yourself, but what about your children? Amen?
Amen.
The way he's living his life, what about your children? What are they going to bear? You see, that is so sad. That when we live our life with wrong concerns, not having a good concerns, not only Lot, he could not manage to save his people. You cannot manage to tell your brother in accommodation, stop drinking because you are drinking with him. You cannot tell your friend stop lying because when you are lying together. You cannot tell stop going, stop doing this because you are doing also. Amen?
Amen.
So it's a call for us today that we have good concerns. Amen?
Amen.
Let us examine our lives. Let us examine ourselves. How is our conscience? Is it good? Is it fair? Is it evil? Or is it sin? But we have Jesus who can make things right again. Amen?
Amen.